company. It's a payment system company. Have you used
that.
PayPal?
Yeah.
Have you used the Cash App?
All right, okay.
Okay, now this is not that, but they're you know.
That's a sector called Finn.
Right.
See, I didn't know that.
And, you know, part of this sort of trajectory we've been on this week with digital currency, cryptocurrency, the democratization of stable money, I had to get the smartest guy we know, and that's David Doerr. David, how are you, man? Good to talk to you.
I'm doing good, guys. Nice to be back with you. Happy New Year to you.
This guy, okay, Alon Gorin, okay, I don't know if you know Alon Gorin. You probably should know him, David. If you don't know, I'll introduce you to him. From Crowd Invest Summit, started off with a crowdsourcing guy, then Crypto Invest Summit, the guy that puts on these big events. You need to be a speaker there, because as smart as Alon is, David is Yoda. Okay, so David is Yoda to, right?
Listen,
first of all, was it you behind Reddit, by the way? Was that you? Were you the Reddit guy? Because it was a guy like you, though, wasn't it?
I will tell you, definitely, if you read the original GameStop post, which I think was posted by a name, Jeff Amazon, I mean, there's no doubt that was a professional trader. Anybody talking about gamma squeezes, that's not your everyday retail trader.
Yeah, no, you're exactly right.
Wow.
Well, let me tell you what. First of all, I want to start having you back on a weekly basis. And you do run a publicly traded company called Coro Global, and their stock symbol CGLO. Which is really interesting in and of itself. And you can go to Coro Globo. CoroGlobal.com. So C-O-R-O dot global. I'll put it up on our website. We have a brand new website, Big Biz Show. I'll also put it out to my 100,000 TikTok followers on Sully Speaks Money. But David, will you break down for us sort of a new data point for us technical traders? And keep in mind, our audience is, you know, guys like you and I, and then also guys like, well, Russ. There used to be three legs to my milking stool, and it was fundamentals when I'm looking at a company. It would be technical analysis. I'm looking at moving average, convergence, divergence. I'm looking at stochastic oscillators. I'm looking at relative strength indicators. But I'm looking at the technicals. Then I would also say the third edge of the milking stool is community. What's in the news? What's the word on the street? But now there's this social involvement.
It's online, huh?
And I've been talking about the three legs of the investment milking stool since we got on the air in the early 90s. But the point is that this social participation can almost be a technical indicator, meaning that the social interaction happens.
Yeah.
Start looking at this. David, am I right on that? You'd be the guy to ask about this.
You're 100% right. I mean, it's a whole new dimension to social sentiment, right? So sentiment indicators are not new, but the virality of stuff is just absolutely incredible. You guys saw the news with Silver Squeeze over the weekend, Thursday and Friday. I mean, it just exploded. You had celebrities tweeting it and talking about it on social media within 24 to 48 hours. That's extraordinary. I don't ever recall seeing anything like that. 99, we had chat rooms. There's all that type of stuff. But this is just it's another dimension.
So for us, talk about, for people not understanding, we talk about decentralizing medicine because it's good for the world, but there's also the decentralization or the democratization of investment opportunity, and that's what I think you saw with Reddit, didn't we? That's sort of what you represent as well. Talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, that's right. So what's happening is that this is just really an extension of what came out of 2008 and 2009, where a lot of people were unhappy with Wall Street. The Occupy Wall Street movement really took hold. And what you're seeing is a lot of kids that they were born during that period, or they were 8, 9 years old, and now they're becoming adults and they're having their first forays with financial technology, and they're upset with the system. And I think that that's a sentiment that, regardless of age, everybody shares. And so they're looking for ways to say, well, how can I participate and not get ripped off? How can I be smart and savvy with my money, but at the same time kind of give my middle finger to the establishment? And you're seeing that. I mean, that's exactly what took place last week with this basically going viral all over the internet. So this is here to stay. I don't see this changing. I think you're going to see a big continuation. And by the way, for you guys, if you haven't seen it, was in the news today. Robinhood actually did a post talking about the dangers of the old system.
Well, it's so interesting. It is smart because, okay, so the funny part about this whole TikTok thing that's happened last week is I went on and I said, look at what's happening with Robinhood is a little it's being mischaracterized in the news. Yeah. They had a responsibility, a FINRA requirement to protect all shareholders, not and all of their, because they're a broker dealer. Yeah. What's interesting is I like how now they're taking this approach of teaching these novice investors who are screaming on the internet, as well as some pretty savvy investors. Is that going to set the stage for the TD Ameritrades of the world and the Scott Trades of the world and the Fidelities of the world, where Johnny Lunchbucket and Cindy CEO trade every single day, but they're sort of been these quiet behemoths because they could, not necessarily because they should. Talk about that a little bit for us, David.
Yeah, I think what's happening is that where smart money is going to go next is, and smart investors, just smart investors and people that are more sophisticated, they're trying to better understand the system. How does the system work? Robinhood's attracted a fleet of new users. And while their whole thing is democratizing access and giving everybody the ability to trade stocks, there's still fundamental issues with the system. The T plus two settlement time is a big aspect of that. So one of the things that we do is we deal with real-time settlement. And everything's going to have to move to that. So I think you're going to see a permanent trend towards understanding market structure by retail traders, whereas before, that would have been something that would have been of no interest. They're just looking for a hot stock tip or a good idea or something that's trending. But I think you're going to see a lot more sophistication about market structure.
So where does that leave the current system of equity trading versus, and I think everybody got a lesson on what short selling is. I mean, by the way, I think the biggest lesson I could give this last week is that stocks are the only asset you can sell before you own. You can't sell a house before you own. You can't sell a car before you own, but you can sell equities. How do you think this is going to change the big picture, David?
I think that it's going to open up a lot of opportunity for fintech players of all varieties. Because, again, we always think that this plumbing, the plumbing is bad. The plumbing doesn't work. It doesn't serve people. And this is creating openings for all sides, front end, mid office, back office, technologies that can serve all of that are ripe opportunities. And while you see the incumbent players looking at those things or investing in the companies, from our experience, most of them are not moving nearly fast enough. And they're comfortable. They're complacent. So they haven't felt the need to. But I think that fire is going to get ratcheted up on them to look at ways to innovate, or they're going to lose market share very quickly.
And you know, what's interesting here is I think as you call it, the importance of democratizing access to stable capital, as well as democratizing the ability to grow that capital, right?
Yes. I think that's important to everyone.
Talk to us a little bit about the impending financial crisis because of the amount of money flow versus interest rates historically. I mean, if you go back to 1943 after World War II, it's the last time we've had money flow that looked like this. Can you give a real quick comment on that one for us? Are we concerned that we have put too much into the system here?
Yeah, of course. So just a point from previous show that I was on with you guys talking about the year-over-year money supply. It's absolutely going berserk, double digits everywhere in all major economies. And this has a real world effect. So since I was last on the show, if we just look at a wide swath of commodities this year, several of them are up double digits. Yeah. Lumber's up double digits, iron ore, coffee, nickel, all these things are starting to take hold. And when that inflation takes root, the destruction that it leaves in its wake is severe.
And that's the piece we have to look at, David, is that money flow equals every single time inflation. Hey, Dave, we'll see you next week. And I just committed you to next week. David Torr, smartest guy I know in this business. Coro.global.com. Stand by. More Big Biz coming up.